I wouldn't do that if I were you.
Wouldn't do what?
What you were thinking of doing.
How do you know what I was thinking?
Oh, we make in our business to know lots of things.
Look, whatever you're selling, I'm not interested. Please, just leave me alone.
No, you don't understand. I've got a job to do here.
I said leave me alone.
This isn't going very well. But you said this is going to be easy. He won't listen. Oh, yeah, I know. But if at first I don't succeed, blah, 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 blah. Have you ever read Tom Sawyer?
What?
You see, there was a very industrious young man, and when the chips were down, he never gave up. You remember why?
Who cares?
He never stopped caring about people in his life, George, but about all the folks who needed him.
You called me George. How do you know my name?
Oh, I know everything about you. I've watched you grow up from a little tiny boy.
How could you? I've never seen you before.
You haven't needed to until now. How's the lip? Looks like it stopped bleeding.
Oh, yeah, that's an answer to a prayer I got a little bit ago.
Oh, no, 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 George. I'm the answer to your prayer.
Who are you?
Leonard Hotbody. AS2.
Hotbody? AS2? What's AS2?
Angel, second class.
Now I know I've lost my mind.
No, George, but you were well on your way. That's why they sent me down. Besides, it's ridiculous to kill yourself over a measly $8,000.
How did you know that?
This is what I've been trying to tell you, George. I'm your guardian angel. I know everything about you.
Well, you look like the kind of angel I'd get. I'll give you that much. Sort of a fallen angel. What happened to your wings?
I haven't won my wings yet, but you are going to change all of that.
I am? How?
By letting me help you.
Only way you can help me is to get me 8,000 bucks before the clock strikes 12. After that, my life turns into a pumpkin.
Sorry, but we don't use money in heaven.
All right, yeah, I keep forgetting. Well, down here, you can't live without it. If the truth be told, I'm worth a lot more dead than alive.
Okay, you mustn't talk like that. I don't think you realize how much it would work. Why, if it hadn't been for you...
If it hadn't been for me, everybody I know would be a lot better off. My wife, my kids, my friends.
You sure got a lot of friends. I'll say that for you. Well, don't you understand that they've jammed up our airways for over an hour now?
What are you talking about?
Prayers. When they're heartfelt, they're mighty powerful missiles. And the ones for you, why, they've lit up our whole celestial system.
Why? How?
It's because they never stopped caring about you, George. Just like Tom Sawyer.
Since when?
Ever since that day you saved your little brother from drowning when he fell through the ice.
I was 12. That was instinct.
Yeah, but there were other boys there that day, too. Some bigger and better swimmers. They didn't obey their instincts. Only you did.
He's my brother.
True, but what about when you saved Gower from ruin? That wasn't instinct. That was courage. Deep-seated and a wrench full of guts courage.
But he had just received a telegram telling him his son had died.
And he had turned me through and through, drowning his sorrow in a bottle. Remember?
George, are you out there? I'm sorry, Mrs. Blaine. The medicine should have been delivered an hour ago. I promise it'll be over in 5 minutes. Where is Mrs. Blaine's box of capsules? Why didn't you deliver them?
I couldn't!
What are you talking about? Why couldn't you deliver them? Don't you know the Blaine boy's very sick?
Mr. Gower, you're hurting my sore ear!
You lazy loafer!
Mr. Gower, you don't know what you're doing! You put something wrong in those capsules!
What are you talking about?
I know you're unhappy. You got that telegram today and it upset you. I understand that, but you put something wrong in those capsules. I'm sure you did!
How do you mean?
Just look and see for yourself. I tried to tell you when you were writing the order, but you wouldn't listen. But just look at the bottle you took the capsules from. It's not right. I swear it isn't.
Oh, no. Oh, no.
Don't hurt my sore ear again. I won't tell anyone, Mr. Gower. I promise. And whatever tell another soul, hope to die, I won't.
Oh, George.
And you never did. Not to this day. That's remarkable.
He always cared about his young people. Gave most of us our first jobs.
He never stopped caring about you, that's for sure. Remember that handsome suitcase he bought for you when you finally thought you were headed off to college?
That was 1,000 years ago.
He's a jolly good fellow, for he's a jolly good fellow, for he's a jolly good fellow, which nobody can deny.
May you always use it in great health, George.
Oh, thank you, Mr. Gower. How can I ever repay you?
By graduating with all honors would make us all very proud.
Ha! Fat chance.
Lay you a bet, little brother.
Haven't got time. I'm off to my dance. How do I look?
Like a goon in a penguin suit.
That's enough, you two. You look very nice, Harry.
Of course he does. It's my tux.
Well, what's your verdict, Aunt Tilly? Do I look good enough to eat?
If you lay a hand on me, young man, I'll hit you with this purse.
Oh, but Aunt Tilly, it's a full moon out tonight, and I'm in love with you.
Ah! Harry, that's enough.
Oh, Mom, I almost forgot. I've got to borrow the car tonight. I'm CEO of the Eats Committee. I have to take over lots of plates and stuff.
Whose plates?
You know, the Good Sunday China.
Harry, you can't be using my Sunday China. It was your grandmother's and her mother's before that. Are you even listening to me? Oh, Georgie, we sure are gonna miss ya.
You too, Vi.
Say, Violet, that's some dress you got on there.
This old thing? It's just a hand-me-down like Harry's.
Well, sure is nice, isn't it, George?
Huh? The dress. Yeah, it looks great, Violet.
Well, I better get going. The dance starts in a half an hour. Why don't you stop by later on?
Just might do that.
Oh, sure, hope you do.
Would you like me and Ernie to walk you over to the school?
That won't be necessary. See you later, Georgie.
Well, come on, Ernie.
See you around, George.
Say, Uncle Billy, where's Pop?
He had to get ready for that stupid board meeting with Potter tomorrow.
I thought when Pop hired him to the board of directors, he'd ease up on us a little bit. What's eating at that money-grabbing buzzard anyway?
Oh, he's a sick man, George. Sick in his mind and sick in his soul if he has one. Hates anybody who has anything that he can't have. Hates us mostly, I'm afraid.
Say, George, you would never consider coming and working in the building alone, would you?
Sorry, Uncle Billy, but not me. I couldn't stand being crammed up in a crummy little office for the rest of my life, trying to figure out how to save 3 cents on a length of pipe. I'd go crazy. I want to do something big, something important.
Well, you see, George, your father and I do feel like we're doing something big, something important. It's deep in the heart of a man to want to own his own house and his own fireplace to sit by at night. And we feel like we can help him get those things.
But, Belle, you've got to admit, this town is no place for any man unless he's willing to call it a Potter. And you've got talent, George. We've all seen it. So you got to get yourself an education and get out of here if you must.
Say, George, you have any idea what you want to do?
Oh, sure. I want to build things, like airways and maybe even cities. It's been a dream all my life.
Still after the first million by your 30th birthday?
Oh no, I sell for half of that in cash.
Well, your Aunt Tilly and I sure are going to miss you.
And I'm gonna miss you both very much. Say, Uncle Billy, would you mind running this into the house for me? I think I might stop in on Harry's dance.
Have a good time, son.
Swimming pool.
buffalo guys, can't you come out tonight? Can't you come out tonight? Can't you come out tonight? Buffalo gals, can't you come out tonight and dance by the light of the moon?
Hot dog, just like the church choir.
Beautiful.
There was quite a commotion in that locker room. I had to jump over three or four people just to get the stuff we're wearing.
Half the town said it wasn't going to be a good idea to build a gym floor of the pool. I wonder who turned the key.
Probably someone jealous because you chose me to dance with you.
You think? Maybe.
Here, let me hold that white old dress of yours. Hello.
Hello. You look at me as if you don't know me.
Well, I don't.
You've passed me almost every day on the street.
Me?
Uh-huh.
Uh-uh. That wasn't you. That was a little girl named Mary Hatch.
Do I look as funny as you do?
Well, I guess I'm not quite the football type. You look wonderful. You know, if it wasn't me speaking, I'd say you were the prettiest girl in town.
Well, why don't you say it?
I don't know. Maybe I will say it. Say, how old are you anyways?
You can't ask that.
Well, I am.
18.
18? Well, it was only last year you were 17.
Too young or too old?
Oh, no, just right. Your age fits you. Yes, sir, I see you look a little older without your clothes on. I mean older. I'm sorry.
Sir, my train, please.
A pox upon me for a clumsy love.
You may kiss my hand.
Mary?
As I was lumbering down the street.
Okay, then I'll throw a rock at the old Granville house.
Oh no, please don't. I love that old house.
No, you make a game of it, see? You throw a rock and try to break a window. You gotta be a pretty good shot nowadays with so many already broken out.
Please don't. I love that old place. I'd like to live in it someday.
In that old thing? I wouldn't live there as a ghost. Look, right there on the second floor.
What you wish for?
Oh, not just one wish, Mary. Oh, hatful. I know I'm going to do today and tomorrow and the next year and year after that. I'm shaking the dust of this crummy little town off my boots, and I'm going to see the world. Italy, Greece, the Parthenon, the Colosseum. And then I'm going to go to college and see what they know. And then I'm going to build things like skyscrapers and cities. Are you going to throw a rock? Hey, that's pretty good. What'd you wish for, Mary?
Buffalo gals, can't you come out tonight? Can't you come out tonight? Can't you come out tonight?
Buffalo gals, can't you come out tonight and dance by the light of the moon?
What'd you wish for, Mary?
Oh, no.
Come on, Mary, what'd you wish for?
If I told you, it might not come true.
What is it you want, Mary? You want the moon? Just say the word, and I'll throw a lasso around it and pull it down to you. That's a pretty good idea. I'll give you the moon, Mary.
I'll take it. And then what?
Well, then you could swallow it and it all dissolves, see? And the moonbeams would shoot out your fingers and your toes, the ends of your hair, and... Am I talking too much?
Yes, you are.
Who's that?
Why don't you kiss her instead of talking her to death?
What?
Oh, youth. You know, it's wasting all the wrong people, Ernie.
You're telling me.
Just wasted. Buffalo gals, can't you come out tonight? Can't you come out tonight? Can't you come out tonight? Buffalo gals, can't you come out tonight and dance by the light of the moon?
Bert, Ernie, why don't you come back here? I'll show you some kissing that'll turn your heads around. George, come quick,
it's your father.
Huh?
He's had a stroke.
I'm sorry, Mary, I've got to go. Did you call for a doctor?
Yeah, Shansky's there now.
It was nice of you to come, Mr. Potter.
Well, I'd say your father was the building loan here in Bedford Falls, George.
I agree, sir.
Of course, he wasn't a businessman, and that's what killed him. Oh, I don't mean any disrespect, George. God rest his soul. He was a man of high ideals, so-called. But these ideals, without common sense, can ruin this town. So at our next Board of Trustees meeting, I'm going to make a motion.
A motion, sir?
A motion to dissolve the institution and turn its assets and liabilities over to receivership.
But, sir...
Take this loan application. The board's to act on this morning to Ernie Bishop.
You know, that fellow walks around all day delivering our mail, usually late because he's always stopping to talk to everyone on his route. Anyway, I happen to know that the bank turned down his loan, but he came to the building alone, and you're willing to build him a house worth $5,000. Why?
Well, you have all the papers right here, sir. His insurance, salary, and I can personally vouch for his character.
Oh, so he's a friend of yours?
Yes, sir.
So if you shoot pool with the manager's son, you can borrow money. And what does that get the building alone? A discontented, lazy rabble instead of a thrifty working class. All because a few starry-eyed dreamers, like your father, stir them up and fill their heads with a lot of impossible ideas.
Now, wait just a minute, sir. My father was no businessman. Even I can tell you that much. Why he ever started this penny-ante building and loan, I'll never know. But neither you nor anybody else can say anything about his character. Why, in the whole 25 years since he and Uncle Billy started this institution, he never once thought of himself or saved any money. But he did save a couple of people from falling to your slums. This so-called rabble you speak about does most of the living, working, paying, and dying in this community. And is it too much for them to work, live, pay, and die in a couple of decent rooms and a bath? My father didn't think so, because to him, people are human beings. But to you, a warped, frustrated old man, they're only cattle. And in my book, that makes him a much richer man than you'll ever be.
I'm not interested in your book, young man. I'm talking about the building and loan.
I know very well what you're talking about, sir. You're talking about something that you can't get your hands on and is galling you. Well, thank you for stopping by, Mr. Potter. I'll see you at the meeting.
You're not on the board.
I hold my father's proxy so I can attend and cast a vote. Because the way I see it, the people of this town need this one-horse institution in order to find a way from keeping themselves from falling to you.
Get me out of here. Sentimental hogwash. I'm still going to make my motion, young man. And we'll see who has the power in this town.
You spoke eloquently at the board meeting that day, and they voted Potter down, remember?
On one condition that I hadn't banked on.
That you take over your father's place, and you did. And you turn over all your school money to your brother Harry and send him off to college.
And he became a football star, made second team All-American.
And you got 4 years older.
Oh, hello, Mother.
What are you doing? Wishing on the moon?
Oh, no, I gave up on that years ago.
Did you know? Mary Hatch came back from school.
Hmm.
Came back just 3 days ago.
Hmm.
Nice girl, Mary.
Hmm.
Kind that will help you find answers, George.
Hmm.
Give me one good reason why you shouldn't call upon Mary.
Sure. Sam Wainwright. Yeah, Sam's crazy about Mary.
Well, she's not too crazy about him.
Well, how do you know? Did she tell you?
No.
Well, how do you know then?
Well, I've got eyes, haven't I? And besides, she lights up like a firefly whenever you're around.
Oh.
And Sam's all the way in New York, and you're here in Bedford Falls.
And all's fair in love and war?
Well, I don't know about war.
You know, Mother, I can see right through you. Right to your back collar button. Trying to get rid of me, huh?
Uh-huh.
All right, old building alone pal, if you insist, I guess I'll go find a girl to do a little passionate necking.
George!
Now, if you'll just point me in the right direction. This direction, good night, Mrs. Bailey.
Hey, Georgie Forgy!
Oh, hello, Vi. How's business at ye old-fashioned permanent wave shop?
It's not a tidal wave yet, but a lot more city mothers are coming in thanks to you. Say, what gives with ya?
Oh, nothing.
Well, where are you headed?
I'll probably just head down to the library.
Say, Georgie, don't you ever get tired of reading about things?
Yes, I do.
Say, Violet, are you free tonight?
Uh-huh.
Are you game? Let's make a night of it.
Oh, what do we do?
Well, we could go to the fields and take off our shoes and walk through the grass.
Huh?
And then we could climb Mount Bedford up to the peaks and watch the sunrise. It'd be a terrific scandal. The whole town would be talking about it.
George, have you gotten mad? You must have lost your mind. Walk in the grass in my bare feet? And Mount Bedford? That's a 10-mile hike.
All right, forget the whole thing. It was just a silly idea.
You're telling me. Good night, George.
Well, there you are.
Hello, Mary.
Have you made up your mind?
How's that?
Have you made up your mind?
About what?
Paying a visit. Your mother phoned and said you were on your way.
My mother called? I didn't tell her I was coming over here.
Well, how did she know?
I don't know. I just happened to be passing by.
Well, would you like to come up on the porch for a minute?
I guess just a minute. When'd you get back?
Tuesday.
Where'd you get that dress?
Do you like it?
It's okay. I thought you were going to go back to New York like Sam and Angie and the rest of them.
Well, I worked up there a couple of vacations, but I don't know. I guess I was homesick.
Homesick? For Bedford Falls?
Yes, and my family and, oh, everything. Are you coming up on the porch?
I guess just for a minute.
Would you rather leave?
No, I don't want to be rude.
Then come on up. Buffalo gals, can't you come out tonight? Can't you come out tonight? Can't you come out tonight? Buffalo gals, can't you come out tonight and dance by the light of the moon?
Mary! Mary! Who's down there with you?
It's George Bailey, Mother.
George Bailey? What does he want?
I don't know. What do you want?
Me? Not a thing.
He's making violent love to me, Mother.
You tell him to go right back home, and don't you leave this house either. Sam Wainwright promised to call you from New York tonight. There he is now. Good night, George.
I better get going.
No, wait a minute. Mary, get the phone. Hello, Sam. How are you? Guess who's here? George Bailey. George, he'd like to speak with you.
Hello, Sam?
Well, George Bailey-Oski, hey, fine pal you are. What are you trying to do, steal my girl?
No, no one's trying to steal your girl. Here's Mary.
No, wait a minute. Wait a minute. I want to talk to both of you. Tell Mary to get on the extension.
He wants you on the extension.
Mother's on the extension. We're listening, Sam.
I have a big deal coming up that's going to make us all rich. George, remember that night in Martini's bar when you told me you read someplace about making plastics out of soybeans?
Soybeans? Yeah, sure.
Well, Dad snapped up the idea. He's going to build a factory outside of Rochester, and here's the point. Mary, you're in on this too. Now listen, George, have you got any money?
Money? Yeah, a little.
Well, now listen up. I want you to put every cent you've got into our stocks. You hear? And George, I may have a job for you. That is, unless you're still married to that broken-down building alone. This is the biggest thing since radio, and I'm letting you in on the ground floor. Mary?
I'm here.
Would you tell that guy I'm giving him the chance of a lifetime, you hear? The chance of a lifetime.
He says it's a chance of a lifetime.
Now listen to me. I don't want any ground floors. I don't want any plastics. And I don't want to get married, ever, to anyone, you hear me? I want to do what I want to do, and you're... Oh, Mary.
Oh, George!
and I chipped in on this. We hooked the float away to Happy Land on the bubbles.
Oh, look at this. Champagne.
Thank you, Ernie.
By the way, where are you going on this here now honeymoon?
Where are we going? Now look at this. Here's the kitty. Count it, Mary.
I feel like a bootlegger's wife. Look.
Now where are we going? A whole week in New York. A whole week in Bermuda. The highest hotels. The richest caviar. The oldest champagne. The newest music and the prettiest wife.
That does it. Then what?
Then what, honey?
Then who cares?
That does it.
Hey, I hate to break anything up, but there's something going on down at the bank. I've never really seen one, but it's all the earmarks of a run.
Oh my God.
Folks, if you have any money in the bank, I suggest you hurry.
I should check this out, maybe.
George, please, let's not stop. Let's go.
It'll only take a minute. Now, right this way, folks. No need to panic. Everything is under control. We have everything figured out.
The meeting isn't for Billy.
This is a pickle, George. This is a real pickle.
Well, how did it start?
How does anything like this ever start? They called our loan.
How much?
All of it. They came and took all of our money.
Holy mackerel.
I've never seen anything like it. The whole town's gone crazy.
Mr. Potter, so what do we owe this unexpected visit?
George, there's a rumor going around town that you're going to close your doors early today. Is this true?
Hold. Not for another 10 minutes. That's our usual closing time.
Well, I'm glad to hear it. Are you all right? Do you need me to call the sheriff?
What for?
Well, mobs get pretty ugly sometimes, you know.
I can assure you, all of our customers are very polite.
I'm sure. George, I'm going all out to help in this crisis. I've just guaranteed the bank sufficient funds to meet their needs. They'll close down for a week and then reopen.
You've taken over the bank?
I may lose a fortune, but I'm willing to guarantee your people as well. Just bring your shares over to the bank, and I will pay 50 cents on the dollar.
I'm sure that won't be necessary. We can take care of our customers right here.
Well, just make sure you don't close your doors before 6 p.m., or you'll never reopen. Ladies, gentlemen, remember, 50 cents on the dollar.
You never miss a trick, do you, Potter? Well, I'm telling you, you missed this one. No, don't panic, folks. You heard Potter. The banks will reopen in a week.
But I've got my money here, George, and I'll take it now.
No, Miss Andrews, you're thinking of this place all wrong. As if the money's here. It's not here. It's in the Grange's house, right next to the Kennedy's house, and Mrs. Macklin's house, and 100 others. You're lending them money to build, and they'll pay it back to you as best they can. Now, what are you going to do, foreclose on them?
I've got $242, George Bailey, and $242 isn't going to break anybody.
All right, Miss Andrews, you sign this, and you'll get your money in 60 days.
60 days?
Now, that's what you agreed to when you bought your shares. Stick to your original agreement, Miss Andrews.
Are you going to do it, Potter? Better to get half than nothing.
Wait. Miss Andrews. Mrs. Thompson. Wait, please. Listen to me. Potter's already got a hold of the banks. He's got the department stores. He's got the bus lines. And he's after us next. You know why? Because we're cutting out on his business, that's why. And if he gets a hold of us, there'll never be another decent house built in this town ever again. We can get through this. We have to have faith in each other. We have to stick together.
But my husband hasn't worked in over a year, and I need money.
How am I going to live until the bank reopens?
We've got doctor bills to pay.
Yeah, George, I need cash.
I can't feed my kids off fame.
How much do you need?
That's right. I've got $2,000. $2,000, everybody. Okay. Miss Andrews, how much do you need?
$242.
Miss Andrews, just enough till the bank reopens.
I'll take $242.
Fine. No, your account's still there. That's a loan. All right, Ernie, how much do you need?
I have about $200 in here, George.
Ernie, please, just enough till the bank reopens.
Well, I suppose $20?
$20, now you're talking. All right, this is Thompson.
But it's your own money, George.
Never mind about that. How much do you need?
I'll get along with $20, all right?
$20. There you go.
And I'll sign a paper.
You'll need a
sign a thing. I know you'll pay it back as best you can. Mrs. Martini?
Can we have $17.50?
Bless your soul, of course you can have $17.50. You got 50 cents? Here, you take over. Hello, Mrs. Bailey.
Hello, Mr. Bailey. How's business?
Booming.
Well, at least you have a place to call home. Most of the windows are busted out, and the roof leaks in a place or two, but the structure's sound and there isn't a crack in the foundation.
What do you mean?
32 Sycamore.
32 Sycamore? But that's...
Remember that night? That's what I wished for, and I've been saving ever since. Happy anniversary.
Happy anniversary? But we've only been married an hour.
An hour? 29 minutes and 40 some odd seconds. Oh. I think that's early enough to celebrate, don't you?
Oh, honey, you're wonderful.
Five, four, three, two, one. Yeah! We did it! $2!
I said we're a couple of financial wizards.
Those Rockefellers.
Crack the safe open for these great big old simoleons.
We can save them for seed.
Here's to Papa Dollar and Mama Dollar, and if we wouldn't have a business, let's hope they have a family real quick.
I wish they're rabbits.
That's great, Aunt Tilly. Here's to the rabbits.
To rabbits!
There will be a brief 10-minute intermission right now. A brief 10-minute intermission.
Wine. May joy and prosperity reign forever. Enter the Martini Castle.
You cannot dismiss this Bailey Park anymore, Mr. Potter. It's cutting deeper and deeper into your rental profits.
The Bailey family has been a boil on my neck long enough.
Mr. Potter, Mr. Bailey's here to see you.
Good. Tell him to wait. Go on.
As you know, he's put up a whole subdivision out next to the cemetery. Dozens and dozens of the prettiest little houses you've ever saw. I'm seriously thinking of purchasing one myself.
Don't you dare.
My point is, Mr. Potter, 90% of the residents used to pay rent to you. Now, if I were you, Mr. Potter...
Well, you are not me.
As you say, I'm just a lowly bank examiner. But if you're not careful one of these days...
I'm a busy man, Miss Carter. I haven't got time for idle conjecture. Good day. Cut into my revenue, will you? Or I'll show you a trick or two, Mr. Bailey.
Yes, sir?
Send Bailey in.
Right away, sir. Mr. Bailey, Mr. Potter will see you now.
Mr. Potter, this is quite an unusual quest.
What's that?
You asking me to visit you?
I don't know what's so unusual about it. I just thought the two of us should get better acquainted. Here, have a cigar.
Thank you, sir. This is quite a cigar.
You like it? I'll send you a box.
Thank you, sir. Now, I'm sure I'll find out sooner or later, but why did you invite me over?
George, that's just what I like so much about you. I'm an old man, and most people hate me. But I don't like them either, so that makes it all even. You know as well as anyone that I've run practically everything in this town but the Bailey Building and Loan. You also know that for a number of years I've been trying to get control of it or kill it. But you have stopped me. In fact, you have beaten me. And anyone in this county can tell you that that takes some doing. Take during the Depression, for instance. You and I were the only two that kept our heads. You saved the building and loan. I saved all the rest.
Well, most people say you stole all the rest.
The envious ones say that, George. The suckers. Now, I've stated my side very frankly. Let's look at yours. Young man, 27, 28, married, making, say, 40 a week.
45.
Out of which, after supporting your wife and your mother, you're able to keep, say, 10 if you skimp. A child or two comes along, and you won't even be able to save 10. Now, if this young man of 28 was a common, ordinary yokel, I'd say he was doing just fine. But George Bailey is not a common ordinary yokel. He's a smart, ambitious young man who's been trying to get out on his own since he was born.
but he has to sit around and watch his friends go places because he's trapped, yes sir, trapped, into frittering his life away playing nursemaid to a lot of garlic eaters. Now, do I paint a correct picture or do I exaggerate?
Now, what's your point, Mr. Potter?
My point? My point is I want to hire you.
You want to hire me?
I want you to manage my affairs, George, run my properties. I'll start you out at $20,000 a year.
$20,000 a year?
You wouldn't mind living in the nicest house in town, buying your wife a lot of fine clothes, a few business trips to New York a year, maybe once in a while even Europe. You wouldn't mind that, would you, George?
Well, what about the building and loans, sir?
Oh, confound it, man. Are you afraid of success? I'm offering you a 3-year contract starting out at $20,000 a year. Is this a deal or isn't it?
Well, would it be alright if I had just 24 hours to think it over?
Sure. Go on home and talk it over with your wife.
I'd like that, sir.
In the meantime, I draw up the papers.
Thank you, sir.
Okay, George.
Okay, Mr. Potter. No. I don't need to speak to anybody. I know my answer now, and it's no, doggone it. You sit here and you think the whole world revolves around you and your money. Well, it doesn't, Mr. Potter. And in the whole vast configuration of things, I say you are nothing but a scurry little spider, you. And that goes for you, too. And you, too.
Why in the world did you ever marry a guy like me?
To keep from being an old maid.
You could have married Sam Wainwright or anybody else in town.
I don't want to marry anybody else. I want my baby to look like you.
But you didn't even have a honeymoon. I promise you married your what?
My baby.
You mean Mary? Are you on the nest?
In manner speaking.
Oh, what is it, a boy or a girl?
You were on top of the world then, George Bailey. Couldn't have been happier.
That was nearly 10 years ago. We've had a war since then.
Yes, and your wife has given birth to not one, but 4 beautiful children. And your brother, Harry, has been decorated with the Congressional Medal of Honor. President decorates Harry Bailey.
Hey, that was this morning's newspaper headline.
Yes, that's right. This morning. Day before Christmas. About 10 a.m. That's when it all started, wasn't it? You were out buying a Christmas wreath. And your Uncle Billy, oh yes, Uncle Billy, was on his way to the bank.
Mr. Potter, how are you today? Oh, let me look at this. Harry Bailey wins Congressional Medal of Honor. Wow, you just can't keep those Bailey boys down, can you?
How does Slacker George feel about that?
Very upset indeed. He only busted 3 buttons off his vest. But you know, he would have won 2 of those medals if he would have been able to go.
I know, he's a bad ear.
Yeah, that. And not every heel was in Germany and Japan.
Give me back my paper. Buy your own if you want to drool over it. Wait a minute. Hey! Ah, yes. Take me straight to the bank.
Extra, extra. Read all about it.
Oh, George, George. It's Harry and Ellen Distance from Washington.
Harry? Well, what do you know?
Harry first charges. It's okay, isn't it?
For a hero? Of course it is. Harry, you'll use seven kinds of a son of a gun. How are you? How's Mother standing it? Oh, really? Mother's having lunch with the president's wife.
Wait till Phil hears about this. What did they have to eat?
What did they have to eat? Really? The Navy's flying Mother home this afternoon.
In a plane?
Yeah. Yeah, sure, I'll ask. Is Uncle Billy here?
No, he stopped at the bank first.
He's not here right now. No kidding.
George.
Wow, I wish I was there.
George, that lady's here again.
Lady?
Bank examiner.
You speak to Antilia for a minute, will you?
George, can I talk to you for a second?
Oh, sure, Vi. If you'll just step right this way into my office, I'll be right with you in just a moment. Hello, Miss...
Carter, bank examiner.
Miss Carter, Merry Christmas.
Merry Christmas.
We're all very excited around here. My brother's just been decorated the Congressional Medal of Honor. President decorates Harry Bailey.
Well, I suppose they do those sorts of things. I trust you had a good year then.
Well, between you and me, Miss Carter, we're broke.
Very funny.
If you'll just step into Uncle Billy's office, we have everything laid out for you.
Now, if you'll cooperate, I want to finish up with you by tonight. I want to spend Christmas in Omaha with my sister and her family.
Oh, I don't blame you, Miss Carter. As soon as Uncle Billy arrives, he'll explain everything to you.
Uncle Billy, long distance, Washington!
Yeah, not now.
But it's your nephew Harry, you remember? Here's Uncle Billy, Harry.
Yeah, hi. Hi, Harry, yeah. Everything's fine, uh-huh. All right, bye.
Mr. Bailey?
Me?
Oh, another Mr. Bailey? Well, you'll do just fine, possibly better. Can I see you in here for a moment, please? I have some questions.
Yeah, just give me a second, 1 second. Where's George?
In his office with Violet Peterson.
I need to speak with him immediately.
Character? Well, if I had character.
Well, it takes a whole lot of character to move away and start all over again. Here. You're broke, aren't you?
No, don't.
No, what are you gonna do? Hawk your frozen hat and walk to New York? You know, food and rent cost money there, the same as it does here.
Yeah, I know.
Besides, that's the name of the business, building and loan. And I know you get a job and pay it back as best you can.
George Bailey, am I sure glad I met you?
Say hello to New York for us.
Yeah, sure will. Merry Christmas, George.
Merry Christmas, Pi.
Mr. Bailey, there seems to be a problem.
A problem?
George, can I speak to you for a moment?
What is it, Uncle Billy? What?
Is that your bad ear?
No.
So you did hear me?
Yeah, how much? That much? Oh, Uncle Billy, are you sure you had it with you? Did you buy anything?
No, not even a stick of gum.
Oh, Uncle Billy, we have to find that money.
I'm thinking.
Oh, Uncle Billy, is there any place in your house you could have hid? Anywhere at all?
No, nothing like that. Nothing like that at all.
Think, Uncle Billy, think.
I am thinking, George. I am thinking. I'm thinking and it hurts.
Now listen to me, you stupid, silly little fool. Do you realize what this means? It means bankruptcy and scandal and prison.
No.
Yes, that's what it means. It means one of us is going to prison, and it's not going to be me.
Where's your coat and hat?
I left it at the office.
wrong?
Nothing is wrong. Everything's fine.
Isn't it wonderful about Harry? I bet I've had 50 calls today about the banquet and the party.
Must she keep playing that?
She's practicing for the party tonight, Daddy.
Mommy says we can stay up till midnight and sing Christmas carols.
You can stay up too, Daddy.
Daddy, the Browns next door have a new car. You should see it.
What's wrong with our car? Isn't it good enough for you?
Yes, Daddy.
You better hurry and shave, George. The family will be here soon.
But the families. I don't want the families over.
What is it, Zuzu?
Oh, she caught a cold. She won a flower at school, and she didn't want to crush it. So she didn't button up her jacket on her way home.
Do you have a temperature?
I don't think so.
Just a teensy one. 99.6. She's going to be okay.
You go back up on upstairs to bed, Zuzu. This floor is cold.
My flower. She needs a drink.
Now.
I'll bring up your flower up a drink in just a second. Now go home.
It's this drafty house. I don't know how we don't have pneumonia by now. It's like living in a refrigerator. I don't know why we had to stay in this Cornwall town anyways.
George, what's wrong?
Nothing is wrong.
Daddy, how do you spell frankincense?
I don't know. Ask your mother.
Telephone! I'll get it.
That Zuzu's teacher?
Yes.
Let me speak to her.
Hello, Mrs. Welch? Yes, this is George Bailey. I'm Zuzu's father. What were you thinking sending her home like that? You really should could have caught pneumonia on account of you. And this is what our tax money goes to pay stupid teachers like you who send her kids home half naked. You know, my kids may not be the best dressed kids. They may not have the nicest clothes, but, oh, that's stupid.
Hello? Hello? I'd like to apologize. Hello? She hung up.
I'll hang her up.
Hello? Oh, Mr. Welch, I'm so glad you called. Gives me a perfectly good time to tell you what I really think of your wife.
George!
Oh, you will, huh? Well, next time you think you're man enough, I'll... He hung up!
Daddy, how do you spell hallelujah?
I don't know! What do you think I am, a dictionary? Jamie, would you keep playing that stupid song? Now stop it! Stop it!
Mr. Potter, I need your help. There's some sort of accident. My accounts are short.
So that's what the reporters wanted to talk to you about.
The reporters?
Yes, they called me up earlier from your building loan. Oh, there's a man from the DA's office over there, too. He's looking for you.
Oh, Mr. Potter, please. I must have misplaced $1,000.
You misplaced $8,000?
Yes, sir.
Have you notified the police?
No. I don't the publicity. Harry's homecoming tomorrow.
They're going to believe that one. What have you been doing then, George? Playing the market with the company's money?
No, I haven't.
What is it then? A woman? You know, it's all over town you've been giving money to Violet Peterson.
What?
Not that it makes any difference to me. But why did you come to me? Why don't you go and ask Sam Wainwright for the money?
I couldn't get a hold of him. He's off in Europe.
Well, what about all of your other friends?
You know as well as I do. They don't have that kind of money. Only you can help me, sir.
I see. Have suddenly become quite important. What kind of security would I have? Do you have any stocks?
No, sir.
Bonds, collateral, real estate?
Well, I have this life insurance policy worth $15,000.
Yes, what is your equity in it?
$500.
Look at you. You used to be so cocky. You were going to go out and conquer the world. You once called me a frustrated old man. Well, what are you but a frustrated young man? You come in here crawling on your hands and knees begging me for help. No stocks, no bonds, nothing but a miserable little $500 equity in a life insurance policy. You're worth more dead than alive. Why don't you go to this riffraff you love so much and ask them for the money? I'll tell you why. Because they'd run you out of town on a rail. Now, since the state examiner is still here, as a stockholder of building a loan, I'm swearing out a warrant for your arrest.
No.
Misappropriation of funds, manipulation.
No, no!
Go ahead, George. You can't hide in a little town like this.
The end of my rope.
And that's where I came in.
You mean you actually heard my prayer up there?
Yours and over a dozen others. You'd be surprised how many people were concerned about you.
Well, not after they find out that I've ruined their lives.
You haven't ruined their lives, George. Besides, it wasn't your fault. It
wasn't my fault. I'm the president of the company. I'm being held accountable.
And you honestly think that killing yourself would make everyone feel happier?
I don't know. I guess it would just been better if I'd never been born at all.
Would you say?
I wish I'd never been born.
You mustn't talk like that. You... Wait a minute. Wait a minute. That's an idea. What do you think? Yeah. That'll do it. All right. You've got your wish. You've never been born.
Thank you. You don't have to make all that fuss about it.
What did you say?
You've got your wish. You've never been born. You haven't a care in the world. No worries, no obligations, no $8,000, and no Potter chasing around the sheriff.
Say something else in this ear.
Sure, you can hear out of it.
Well, that's the darndest thing. I haven't heard a thing out of this ear since I was a little kid. Where's your wife?
They're home. They're all home. And that makes it a Merry Christmas, doesn't it, gents?
But I just saw her a minute ago with lots of other women and children, too.
What are you gonna do? Rat us out?
Hey, I know you. You're that fellow that just hit me a minute ago.
I did? You guys hear that? I hit him. Did it hurt?
Yeah. I'll leave the sucker alone. He's worse off than we are.
Hold on. Here comes that panhandler. He's caught up with us.
Come on. Let's get out of here.
Mr. Gower?
Come on. I tell ya, I don't like messing with that guy.
Any of you got a dime or two to spare? Or a drink? I'll settle for a drink.
Mr. Coward, it's me, George Bailey. I used to work for you on the corner drugstore.
Now I know I don't like that rumhead. He spent 20 years in jail for poisoning a kid.
That's right. And if you know him, then you must be a jailbird yourself. Come on, boys, let's get out of here.
Oh, wait a minute. Wait for me.
You see, George, you weren't there to stop Gower from putting the poison into the bottle.
I wasn't there? What do you mean? I remember distinctly. Look, who are you?
This is what I've been trying to tell you all of this time, George. I'm your guardian angel.
But I don't get it.
What don't you get? Do you not understand? This is what you asked for. It's what you wanted. It's all because you were not born.
What do you mean I wasn't born? I was born right here in Bedford Falls on July 12th, 1907.
You won't find any public record of that. And besides, this isn't Bedford Falls anymore. It's Pottersville.
No. No.
Yes, and I'm afraid so. And there is no George Bailey. Never has been. You see, George, you've been given a great gift. A chance to see what the world would be like without you.
Violet?
That's what they call me.
Oh, Violet, am I glad to see you.
And am I glad to see you.
No, Violet, it's me, George.
Of course it is. And if anyone asks, I've never heard or seen of you before.
No, Violet, you have to remember me.
I don't think so, good looking. Why don't you help me?
Well, your name's Violet Peterson, and you were born right here in 1911, and you went to local high school.
What are you, some sort of private eye? Don't you guys ever give it a break? It's Christmas Eve, for God's sake.
No, Violet, you have to remember me.
Oh, yeah, I think I do. Hear no evil, see no evil, speak no evil. That's my motto. So if you don't mind, I'll be on my way.
Violet!
Or I'll make a phone call, George, or whatever your name is. And I don't think you want that. So Merry Christmas!
just need to figure some things out.
I told you, there's no vacancy. And besides, I don't take in strangers unless they're referred by someone. Go try on Maple, 163 Maple.
Your brother-in-law, Uncle Billy.
How do you know?
Well, I've seen him around.
When? When did you see him around?
This morning at his house.
That's a lie. He's been locked up in the state asylum ever since his business failed.
Your son, Harry.
My only son broke through the ice and drowned at the age of 9.
No, he's a war hero. He's coming home tomorrow.
I'm calling the police.
Strange, isn't it? Each man's left after so many other lives, and when he isn't there, he leaves an awful hole, doesn't he?
But he saved every man on that transport. It was in it was in every newspaper headline.
Every man on that transport died, George. Harry wasn't there to save them because you weren't there to save Harry. You see, you really did have a wonderful life. Don't you see what a mistake it would be to throw it all away?
Clarence?
Yes, George?
Where's Mary?
Well, I don't think that,
If you know where she is, please tell me.
You're not gonna like it, George.
Please, is she alive?
Yes, hey, she's alive, but something happened. But she's not the Mary you used to know.
Mary?
There must be some kind of easier way to get my wings.
Mary?
Who are you? What do you want?
It's your husband, George Bailey.
I don't know what you're talking about.
Mary, what happened
please,
to us?
Please don't come any closer. I can't stand being touched. Please, somebody help.
Mary, wait. Clarence, take me back. Please. I'll do anything. Just take me back to my wife and my kids. Please, Clarence. I want to live again.
George, what's the matter?
I didn't do anything to her, honest!
What are you talking about? What in the Sam Hill are you yelling for, George?
Don't!
George?
Wait. Bert. Do you know me?
Know you? I've been looking all over for you. Half the town's out looking for you.
Mary?
Yeah, Mary called. So did Martini, and your Uncle Billy, and even your mom called. What's going on here, George?
What's going on? Well, look around you, Bert. It's breathing. It's moving. It's alive. Oh, Merry Christmas, Bert.
I think I better take you home.
No, honestly, Bert, I'm fine. Yes! Bank examiner.
Mr. Bailey, there seems to be a deficit. You must talk about
it. Oh, yes. Isn't it wonderful? Oh, look at this drafty house. Have you seen my wife? Mary!
Merry Christmas, Daddy!
Oh, you wonderful children. I could eat you up, but where's your mother?
Jonathan, for you and Uncle Billy. George, darling!
Hallelujah! Oh, you're real. Let me touch you. You have no idea what happened to me.
You have no idea what happened. Come right up here and stand right here. I can hear him, George. It's a miracle, a miracle. Come on in, Uncle Billy.
George, it was incredible.
Mary collected a few people and then went door-to-door collecting money. They said, if George is in trouble, he can count on us. I've never seen anything like it.
What is this, George? Another run on the bank?
I wouldn't have a roof over my head if it wasn't for you, George.
Glad to do it, George.
Any time for you, Mr. Bailey.
I made the round of all my charge accounts, George.
Oh, I've decided not to go to New York, George.
All right, quiet, everybody. This is from London. Mr. Gower cables you need cash. Stop. My office has instructed to advance you $25,000. Merry Christmas, Sam Wainwright.
George! Harry! Oh! Looks like I'm just in time. I'd like to propose a toast to my big brother George, the richest man in town.
To George!
Oh wait, I almost forgot. Some little old man at the airport told me to give you this in person.
Tom Sawyer? Who would give you a beat-up copy of Tom Sawyer?
Dear George, remember that no man is a failure who has friends. Thanks for the wings. Love, Clarence. It's from a very good friend of mine, like all of you. Merry Christmas.
Daddy?
What is it, darling?
Hear the bell? Teacher says every time a bell rings, an angel gets his wings.
That's right. Attaboy, Clarence.